We are starting afresh. So change the topic. Change the topic. The offices.
And the gifts.
The gifts.
And the food.
The food. And the Holy Spirit. And we will look at them one by one. I just wanted us to take this in and brush over it and leave it, but I think it won't work that way. There are several things to know. So we will quickly brush over it as we learned last Sunday. So those of you who are not here can also receive something fresh. And we will add a few things and leave. Praise God.
Amen.
The offices. What are the offices? Let's read our theme scripture. Ephesians chapter 4.
4:10.
Reading from 10 to 12. He who ascended is also the one who descended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. 11. And he himself gave some to the apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. And I told you these are the offices of the church. They are not offices of the Holy Spirit. He gave it, but it's not for him, it's for the church. Those are the offices of the church. Okay, let's take them one by one, so that those of you who are not here can hear from me. Let's take the evangelist first. Who is the evangelist, or who is an evangelist? We said, let's imagine the whole world as a field, and the people in it as a soul. So the evangelist goes out to the field to reach out to the souls, to preach to them, to talk to them, to let them hear at least about the existence of God or the kingdom of God or anything. And they go out in the form of crusades, conferences, outdoor programs, or any form. It can be one-on-one evangelism. Going out to share the word to the souls, for them to hear about the kingdom. And then they bring these people, they sweep them into the church. So they preach to the church, to the souls, they lead them to Christ, and then they introduce them, they introduce their church to them, to bring them into the church. So the evangelist goes out there, preach to the souls, and bring them in. That is the work of the evangelist. And then when the souls get in, what is the work of the pastor? The pastor takes over. The pastor is the one to take care of the souls brought in by the evangelist. The pastor will now take over, take care of them, feed them with the word of God, nurture them, make sure they are growing. And the pastor is the one that looks into their various lives, their education life, their studies, their personal life, their spiritual lives. The pastor looks into it and makes sure they are growing in the things of God. And after the pastor teaching them the word of God, the word of God given to the souls by the pastor is usually shallow. It's usually shallow. So the teacher step in. The work of the teacher is to take the souls deeper into the word of God. The teacher is to take the souls deeper into the word of God. He explained the scriptures to them, defined terms for them, terms like righteousness, holiness, sanctification, salvation, or any word that the pastor might mention without giving the definition. And some statements the pastor may make, plain statements like that, the teacher explain those statements to them and make sure they understand, their understanding is open. And then after that, sometimes there are situations whereby the evangelist, after preaching to the souls, maybe here we are, and then we send an evangelist to another city. And after preaching to them, so many people gave their life to Christ, the city is very far away from here. There wouldn't be a need to bring the souls in here. So we will send an apostle to the souls there to start a new church with them. So what is the work of the apostle? Is to establish new churches, is to build new churches, going around planting new churches. Or an apostle is somebody sent on a specific mission to carry out a specific mission at a particular place. That is the work of the apostle. And then we have the prophet. What is the work of the prophet? The prophet is to bring down, or is to tell the souls, the mind of God concerning the church. The prophet is to bring down the mind of God concerning the church, or a person, a place, it can be anything. That is the work of the prophet, is to feed the souls with the mind of God at a particular time. Those are situations where you ask the prophet, what is in the mind of God concerning me? If God, should God mention your name, what would he say next? What is in the mind of God concerning you? Well, our church, what is in the mind of God concerning our church? Our fellowship, what is in the mind of God concerning our fellowship? If God looks down to our fellowship, what is he thinking? Then the prophet will be able to tell whether the fellowship is on track or the fellowship is going off track. The prophet will be able to tell various problems of the members, or whatever God wants to do in the life of the members. So those are the offices and their works. And we established the fact that every church is supposed to have all these five offices. Every church should have an evangelist, a pastor, a prophet, a teacher, and an apostle. Every church should have all of them. Why? We are not done with our theme scripture. Okay, let's read on. Our theme scripture. Ephesians 4:10. Okay. 11. 12. For the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, and for the edifying of the body of Christ. That is the purpose of the offices. The offices are given to equip the saints. Some other versions say to edify them, or and also for the work of the ministry. The offices are also for edifying the body of Christ. Those are the reasons why the pastor, the prophet, and all the five offices are given. And then we were saying every church is supposed to have all the five offices. In case there is a church who has some and don't have the others, they may not be edified in that area where the one they lack, the one they don't have. Let's take our fellowship as an example. Martin, which office do we have here operating among us? The five offices. The teacher. The teacher and the preacher. The figure, which office do we have? And which one can you identify?
Teacher.
A teacher. Alright. So this is where we are all saying we have only a teacher. And we don't have a pastor, we don't have a prophet. apostle is not here, an evangelist is not here. Therefore, we will lack the voice, the prophet. We won't have an evangelistic ministry. An apostle will not be there, and the pastoral office will not be there. You see? But if those set of offices were also to be among us, we would have grown higher than we are today. Because sometimes it takes, there are something that takes us some amount of time to understand. If we were to have a prophet that would tell it direct, there wouldn't be a need to be spending all this time trying to figure it out. You see, if somebody is confused about something, and all the offices are working, we just step into one of them and find out. You see, maybe you are hearing a voice, you are not really sure as to whose voice, which voice is this. You can step into any of the offices to find out how clear or which voice is this. They will be able to help you. But for now, we have the teacher, only the teacher, working here. And we also made establish the fact that each and every each one of these offices, the five offices, they work together. They work together. They are not far away from each other. And they can step into other offices. A pastor can step into the office of a teacher and teach, but he is not the teacher. Same way, a prophet can teach, but he is not the teacher. An apostle can preach, but he is not a pastor. Same way, a pastor can prophesy, but he is not a prophet. You get it? If it is not very clear, let's take this example. When the apostle is sent to a village to start a church, or a city or a particular place to start a church, the apostle cannot just go there, gather the souls, and say, well, this is your church, and step out. No. After planting the church, he will serve as a pastor for some time. He will begin to preach to them the word of God for some time. So here, he was sent as an apostle, but he is now doing the work of a pastor. And then while he is preaching to them, you will see a pastor will rise among the people. A prophet will rise among the people. An apostle will rise among them. A prophet will rise among them. And when some of these offices are identified among the people, the apostle leaves the church for them, and he goes out to establish a new church. Do you see it? That is how it works. When we are here and we need the voice of God immediately, and the prophet is not at work, anybody who is at work, any of the offices or any of the pastor or any of the offices at work can step into the office of the prophet to bring down the mind of God at that particular time. But he is not a prophet. Do you see it? Alright, so what does Bibi say about the offices? You have forgotten?
We made a clarification that here they call the callings.
Okay, yeah.
The callings.
We said the offices are gifts because first of all, Jesus said he gave. He gave, they are gifts. And because we also have some other gifts given to men by the Holy Spirit. So we call the offices callings. You are called to be a pastor, you are called to be a prophet, you are called to be an apostle. Callings. And then we also said that how do you get these callings? Well, God can call you directly. Give you a mission, it's also a calling. Which other way can you be called? You can be ordained. You can be ordained to be a pastor, or you can be ordained to be a prophet, you can be ordained to be any of them. Another way you can have a calling is also through passion. When you have passion for souls, or you get to a place and you think the people need a prophet, or the people need a pastor, and you think you can start it. You can start working the pastoral work at that place. So passion can also drive you to any of these offices. You see, passion can also drive you to this any of these offices. If you know the word of God and you get to a place and you think the people there doesn't know much like you know, and you start teaching them, well, you have started the teaching ministry. You have started the teaching ministry. And he also said one of them can also step into the other and operate there for some time. Our fellowship, have you ever seen the teacher stepping into any other office? Mm-hmm. Have you ever seen it before? Mm-hmm. Have you ever experienced it? Mm-hmm. The teacher stepping into another office?
Yes, sir.
Yes, it is possible. You can step into another office and then you work there, but you are not in charge of that office. You must know your office and operate from there. We made establish the fact that every office has an anointing and a grace attached to the office. Each and every each one of these offices has a special anointing and grace that functions in the office. Like most of our countries, we have the office of the president. If 3 years old boy is selected to be the president, it is not his age that will give him such a power. It's the office. There are things that are attached to the office of the president. So whoever step into it has to enjoy it. It doesn't matter where he comes from, how old he is, or whatever. As far as you are able to step into that office, those things begin to function in your life. You will have the same authority. Anybody who will be a president will have. You will have the same thing. So if anybody is functioning in any of these offices, you will have to function in the same grace, the same anointing is given to you. And it is the anointing that will make the person a bit different from any other person. But apart from that, nothing much. Until the grace and anointing begin to function in your life, you'll be at the same level as you'll be as any of the members. But when you are at work in that office, the grace and anointing begins to function for you. So it will make the work easier for you. You'll be able to do supernatural things, things your own ability cannot do. But because you are in that office, you will be able to do it. And we saw from verse 10 that these gifts are given to the church by Christ. Is given to the church by Christ. In other words, God, Christ Himself, calls out some people to lead His church through the 5 offices. He calls out various people to lead His church. And we said that the pastor, when you get to the pastoral of a class, like the pastor can just, that is where we have preaching, we preach the word of God in the pastoral office. When you get to church on Sunday, we mostly see the pastor at work preaching, and mostly we don't ask questions because the pastor is at work. He speaks so fast, he can do anything, he can jump, he can anoint, he can make altar call. He is at work. That is his work. And we don't ask him questions. You leave him, he talk and talk and talk and talk, and he step down. And then mostly, various churches, Wednesday, you see the teacher at work. The word that the pastor shared, the question that the brethren would have loved to ask but didn't get a chance, they take it to the Wednesday, the teacher's class, to ask those questions and to find answer to those questions. Or the teacher will take the word, break it down for those at the lower level to get exactly what the pastor was saying. Because there are some pastors that preach at a very high level of maturity. They are so mature that that when they preach, if you are not at that such a level, you will see, this man of God didn't preach very well. Meanwhile, it's because the level is too high. Most of us have that problem. We classify some men of God as their message is not really good. But sometimes it is not so. It is rather too good, above your standard. But those who are at the same level may get it, you see. And those seated there, they know what he means, because he taught them from the beginning. They grew together, so they'll be able to understand. So that is the offices. And beside the offices, we have the gifts of the Holy Spirit, which are special gifts given to the church. These gifts given to the church is not like the office. They are just gifts. And these gifts can be given to anybody. Anybody can receive such a gift at any time. And when you receive such a gift, it is not an office. That is one thing children of God has to be very mindful of. Most of our brethren, when they receive any of these gifts, they turn it into an office. They become a pastor or a prophet. But it is not an office, it's not a calling. It's just a gift that God has given them. That is how we get so many false prophets around today. Most of them didn't go to the shrine for power to come and start a church. They actually got the gift from God. Maybe gift of speaking in tongues. He got it from God. He spoke in tongues. He can speak in tongues very well. And then he thinks now, mature now. So he gets out to establish his own church because he can speak in tongues. Another gift is gift of prophecy. You know, we have gift of prophecy and the office of prophet. You see, there are two different things. The office of a prophet is different from the gift of prophecy. But mostly when our brethren get a gift of prophecy, they jump into the office. They become prophets. And there is a way the gift works, and there is a way the office works. And if you have a gift and you are going to change the gift into an office, very soon you will become a liar. I will explain why. Very soon you will begin to lie to your brethren. I will explain why. Okay, let's look at the gift. Let's read the thing scripture that talk about the gift. 1 Corinthians chapter 12:7-11.
Now to each one the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one there is given through the Spirit the message of wisdom.
Okay, to that's another, number one. The message of
wisdom.
Message of wisdom. Mm-hmm.
To another the message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. Mm. To another faith by the same Spirit. Mm. To another gifts of healing by that one Spirit. Mm. To another miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. Mm. To another, distinguishing between spirits. Mm. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. Mm. And to still another, the interpretation of tongues. Okay. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he gives them to each one, just as he determines.
According to the Spirit. The Spirit of God gives these gifts to each and every one of us, according to his will, as he wishes. Display the gifts. Let's look at the gifts. We have 9 gifts of the Spirit that he gives to the church. First one is what? Word of knowledge. The second one is what? Word of wisdom. The third one is what? Gift of prophecies. Gift of faith. Gift of interpretation of tongues. Gift of working of miracles. Gift of healing. Gift of discerning of spirits or discernment of spirits, and gift of diverse tongues. We have talked about this before, right? In a shallow way. Okay, today we'll go deep, we'll go down. Alright, let's take them one by one. What is word of knowledge? This is a gift beside the offices the Holy Spirit gives to individuals. Are you getting the difference? Get the difference between the offices and the gifts. The gifts is given to, the offices are given to specific people and they are called into an office, full-time ministry, to work for the edification of the brethren, for the edification of the church, and for the edification of the body of gifts to the church, to the members. And this gift, anybody among the congregation can receive any of these gifts as the Spirit of God wills. If you read one by one, he keeps saying, by the same Spirit, is giving to another interpretation of tongues by the same Spirit, to another the gift of faith by the same Spirit. So the same Spirit that gave the offices is the same Spirit that gave the gifts. You see it? So, under the office, the gifts can operate. Mind you, the gift does not only operate in the church. When we say interpretation of tongues, many people think when we are in church and somebody is speaking in tongues or somebody cried out in tongues and somebody interprets it, it is beyond the church. This one is given, these gifts are given to be taken out there to go to the battlefield. The first one is what? Word of knowledge. What is word of knowledge? Word of knowledge is the Spirit of God, which is the Holy Spirit, transmitting his specific knowledge to you on something that you would have no ability or means to be able to know with your own limited intelligence or knowledge. Let's take an example to explain, to go through it. The word of knowledge is when the Spirit of God gives you specific knowledge concerning something. You want to know about something, or you don't know how to go about something, but it is needed. You have to go about it. You have to solve it. You have to bring it out. At that particular time, the Spirit of God can give you a gift to know about it, to have a knowledge about this thing you are dealing with. And then that knowledge given you at that particular time is what we call the word of knowledge. And this wisdom, this knowledge given you can be very accurate because it is given from the Spirit of God himself. And it's a direct message. You may not hear the voice in your spirit or in your ears telling you about it. But when the gift is activated in you, you will see you just did it and it worked. But before, you had no idea about the whole thing. I'm not talking about where you get to the place, the address, and you go like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and you choose one and it hits. Not that one. Here, when the Holy Spirit gives you this gift at a particular time, you don't only get to choose and choose right. You even know knowledge, you have knowledge about what you are doing. Meanwhile, you never learned it before. How many of you ever experienced such a gift? You have no idea about the thing, but you just went about it, did it, and it worked. How many of you have ever experienced it? It is something very common, and it happens on a daily basis. When we say this gift, don't look at it so high. No. It's something that happens in our lives on a daily basis. I love this gift a lot. That is the gift that made me to study all these softwares. I just think it, and you bring it you bring it out. Nobody ever teaching you. Nobody ever lecturing you about it. You never go to any class. But you just know it. When somebody asks you, how did you know it? You can't tell. When somebody asks you, who taught you? You can't tell. But you just know it. That is the gift. You see it? That is the gift. And this gift, it is not a gift you really pray for. It can get activated anytime. If only you are connected to the Spirit of God, and this is a child of God that gets stuck at a place, don't know what to do, the Spirit of God will just activate you, and you just have a knowledge about what you are doing. That is the gift of knowledge. And God gave this gift, the Spirit of God gave this gift to the brethren to go about their daily-based activities. Because there are so many things that we have no idea of, but we are called to deal with them. There are people, when this gift gets activated, when you are with somebody, you just know the person. When you speak to him, whether he believes it or not, you just know. He didn't believe what I said. As to how, you don't know, but you just know. When you are with somebody, you know, when I say this thing, the person will get angry. You just know it. And should you try to say it, the person will truly get angry. That is the gift at work. So it's a gift that works on daily basis. It's not anything so strange. People think, you know, but you see, when people receive such things, they become like this in the church. So we see this gift as big things. No, it's something that works on our daily activities. As you go about your activities in the day, this gift gets activated from time to time, from time to time, from time to time. Most of you could travel through a very big airport without asking anybody, where should I go, where should I go? Sometimes this gift can get activated. You just keep moving. You turn right, you turn left. You are just going. So you get there. Your bag is there. You pick it and you go. That is the word of knowledge. The Spirit of God rubbing his idea or his knowledge. Remember, the Spirit of God have knowledge, accurate knowledge about everything. So when you need it and he gives it to you, that is it. Do you get it? Do you understand this gift now? So it's a gift. It has almost worked in the life of each and every one of you. Maybe you are not conscious. So what do you do when you are in a situation and you need a knowledge about something? Activate the gift. Say, dear Holy Ghost, I need your idea here. I need your knowledge here about this thing. How should I go about it? Ask the Holy Spirit, how should I go about it? And when you finish praying that prayer, start to do it. Don't wait until I'm waiting for the reply. No. Right after the prayer, begin to do it. Anyhow, just begin to do it. The gift will get activated. And then you will see, you bring the task to pass successfully. Praise God. Amen. Let's go to the next gift. The word of wisdom. How many of you have ever experienced wisdom? Only a few of you. Maybe you have knowledge of what the whole thing is. Somebody said, maybe I have, yeah, but I don't know. But if I raise up my hand and I ask what is it? I won't ask you. I won't ask you. You won't raise up your hand. Alright. The word of wisdom as a gift that the Holy Spirit gives to us. You know, sometimes there is a difference between knowledge and understanding, right? Yeah. Sometimes you can have the knowledge about the thing, but you just don't know exactly what to do. You just don't know exactly what to do. You know, when I click here, this will happen. When I click here, this will happen. When I click the other part, this will happen. You know all. But you don't know which one to click. 7 o'clock. Even though you know, have all the knowledge, if I click this, all the options are between you, are just before you. You have all the knowledge, but you don't know which one to take at this particular time. Then the gift of wisdom is needed. What is wisdom? I told you, it's a force. It will cause you to click one, and it is the right one. And it is the right one. So sometimes we have knowledge, the word of knowledge, about particular thing, but it is not enough. Even though the Holy Spirit rubs his knowledge on us, is transmitted to us, is imparted to us, and we have knowledge about it, but it's still not enough. We don't know what to do with the knowledge we have. Is it possible you can have knowledge and don't know what to do with it? It is very possible. You see, most of us, we know several things in our mind, We even have ideas of some businesses, but we just don't know what to do. If you can activate this gift, the gift of wisdom, the Spirit can cause you, just lead you to a particular place, do something once, and that is it. You hit it. The gift of wisdom is needed. When the knowledge is not enough, after having all the knowledge, and it is still not enough, sometimes choice. Here you find yourself between two guys or two ladies, and they are all just wonderful. You just don't know where to go. You have knowledge about them, all of them. But still, you need a point to cut out one of them. But the point is just not coming. They are all wonderful. They have it all. Then you need this gift to take you to the next level. Wisdom will tell you, choose this one. Choose this one. And that is it. And this is also a gift that operates in us on daily basis. On daily basis. It will cause you to do it. So what is, okay, display the definition and let's read it and see if we can get something back from that. Word of wisdom is the ability to be able to properly, because sometimes we have the knowledge and we don't know how to go about it. So the gift of wisdom will cause you to properly apply the knowledge. You properly apply the knowledge that you may already have on a particular situation. So the knowledge you have, the gift of wisdom will help you, will give you the ability to be able to apply it. But you see, there's something about wisdom. Anytime you hear the word wisdom, think about the first part. Sometimes wisdom functions without your knowledge. Mostly wisdom functions without your knowledge. You finish doing it before you realize it. Example, you could see somebody standing at the place. And then suddenly he moved back. One, two. And right after, something just fall. Right at where he was standing. If you tell him, why did you move back? He can't tell. That is wisdom. He'll push you back. And then whatever will happen. That is wisdom. When you take wisdom to an examination hall, you can write nonsense. Just start writing. When wisdom gets activated, you write the best definition. Meanwhile, you never knew the definition before. That is how most of us pass exams. You say, I didn't write much, but you know, we come out and you see us speaking those things. Wisdom was activated. You just write, that is what we call grammar. Just write anything. Just write anything. Yourself, you may call it nonsense. But when the wisdom holds your hands to write, he will put full stop where it's supposed to be. He will bring the comma. The set, he will hold your hands to write it. And after you finish writing, you yourself, you read it, you say, this one, I'll get it wrong. Meanwhile, it's the best you have written. When the teacher read it, you say, wow, this guy is really steady. Meanwhile, throughout the whole semester, it didn't look really good. And wisdom took most of us throughout our education life. Not because we were the best students, not because we studied so hard. Like how people would spend the whole night cracking the book. Those are people who believe in modular. It is good. You see, if you can crack the book, it is good. But if you can't, then activate wisdom. When wisdom is not there, activate favor. If favor is not there, grace is there. So all these things, they can take you through life without working on your muscle. Many people got jobs after they have failed. And many people were denied interviews after they had all the A's. So, what about that? All right. What is the next gift? Let's explain the last one.
Prophecy.
Word of prophecy, I think this is where the problem is. The church has some problem as to dealing about the office of a prophet and the gift of prophecy. What is the gift of prophecy? Gift of prophecy is when you receive A direct word from the Lord to usually give to someone else. When you bring prophecy down to yourself, okay, I'll explain the difference between the office and the gift. You know, this gift, the difference between the gift and the offices is that the office is 24/7 at work. If you wake a prophet up and you needed the word, he can give it. But the one with the gift, it comes time to time. That is one way to identify a false prophet. They don't give the word always. So if I am operating with the gift and I turn myself to a prophet, what will happen? When somebody needs the word at a particular time and they approach me as a prophet, meanwhile, I only have the gift which comes time to time. And maybe at that particular time, it is not here. But I have to prove I'm a prophet, so I have to manufacture something. You see, that is how false prophets, when we talk about false prophets, don't look at those who go to the shrine. Only few people go there. Majority of them, they actually give the receipt from God, and they corrupted it. So the word of prophecy is when you receive a direct word of God and you give to somebody, and it's one of the best gifts ever. Where you can tell somebody, brother, and you deliver, and that is all. Remember, it's a direct word. It comes hot. I mean hot. Receiving a direct word of God for a group of people or for a particular person. And you see, sometimes it's difficult to differentiate. Is this really a direct word? Alright, let's define it. Gift of prophecy is the same as it's when you receive the word of God. Alright, let's say some things about this gift. It's very, very important. Let's say a few things about this gift. What's the time?
51.
Okay. Gift of prophecy. When you receive gift of prophecy for somebody, remember it's not for you, for somebody. Hear very well. And when you hear, write it down and deliver it to the right person. Mostly, prophecy is supposed to be written down and delivered to the right person. But if it is something you can deliver straight, fine, it is also acceptable. Because it's a direct word from God. So it must be handled very well. Don't add your own to it. Don't take your own out of it. Just give it the way it is. Write it down. And make sure you carry it through the right medium to the right person. When you receive prophecy for a group of people, deliver it through the right channel. Deliver it through the right channel. If any of you receive a word of prophecy among you, maybe concerning somebody or all of us as a group, you deliver it through the right channel to the members. That way, it will edify them. What do we see in the gift of prophecy? Prophecy should be able to
edify,
exalt, and it should give comfort. That is what prophecy does. Prophecy should be able to edify you, should be able to exalt you, and to be able to comfort you. I think we can't explain those words. They are just English words. If you don't know the meaning, go and find the meaning in the dictionary. It's the same thing. Prophecy can also bring confirmation. Prophecy can also bring confirmation about what God has done already. Prophecy can also tell the future. Prophecy can tell the now. Somebody can receive a word of prophecy concerning the now, concerning the tomorrow to come, or the past. And prophecy can give a comfort, a confirmation. It can confirm something to you. And prophecy can also give you a counsel. Mark these things well, because we only know the three. It should give exhortation, confrontation, and exhortation. There are other ones. It can also give confirmation. It can give counsel. The same way, prophecy can give you encouragement. How many of you have ever heard any prophecy in any of these things and say a confirmation, a confirmative prophecy, confirming something? Yes, it's brother A. Those moments you go like, wow, I get it. Because it's confirmed. What about counsel? You hear a prophecy that is giving counseling to somebody. Counseling the person. What about encouragement? Some of you haven't been to prophetic classes before. How do you identify a prophecy? It's a word to you. If I speak a word to you, and the things we are saying is how you use to identify it. It will be for you. I see sometimes the way this thing works is the reason why we miss it. The reason why we miss it. Because when the gift gets activated, sometimes mostly the person's eyes won't change red. That is what most of us we look for. When the man of God's eyes change red, we say, yeah, he's now in office. It won't change red. Sometimes you'll be with a man of God, you keep talking and talking and talking, and he's bringing wisdom, and he's bringing wisdom, knowledge, prophecy, all the gifts at the same time through the talking. What do you have to do? You have to listen. And when he's flowing like that, and you say something very funny, you may cut the flow. That is it, you may miss it. You may cut the flow. Remember, the gift is not him, he's not the one operating it. Well, let me say this thing about gifts, and we close. We'll deal with the, how many? Three now. We have six more. There are nine gifts. That again, you will bring the rest later. Any gift that God gives you, any gift at all, whether it is part of the nine, because we have other gifts too. How many of you speak in tongues here? It's a gift you receive. Were you born speaking in tongues? No. So it's a gift you receive along the way. Any gift at all you receive from God, number one, you will account for it. As to how you used it, you will account for it. You will tell God about the gift. Most of us receive the gift of speaking in tongues. We only speak in tongues in Friday services. How pity. Somebody even speak. And let's not believe it. Meanwhile, the gift kept coming and coming and coming and coming. Who is here and doesn't believe the gift of speaking in tongues? I mean, ordinary speaking in tongues. If I'm sharing with you and I speak in tongues, and you believe the message I'm sharing with you, but you don't believe the gift at work in me, what a contradiction. You see it? Alright, so any gift you receive, you will account for it. Number two, any gift at all you receive from God, for the start, God himself will keep the gift operating on you. He will activate it on you, and he may stop. He may stop the operation of the gift on you, for the start. When you need the gift, God himself will activate it. And when the work to be done is done, he may cut the flow. And then when you prove faithful, you are using the gift well, you prove faithful in the gift, he leaves the gift with you. Most of us, we have our gift of speaking in tongues left with us. I can start it when I like, I can stop it when I like. It is now with me. But when you receive the gift for the start, you see starting it, sometimes it's a problem. You have to pray with English. Oh Lord, as we thank you, we glorify your name, we praise your name, then it just comes along. And they say, amen, 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 you calm down. The flow has cut. You have to start it again. You see, you keep struggling with it that way. But it will get to a time where the gift will be left with you to operate it yourself. The same thing with any of these gifts, the 9 gifts. You can have the gift of wisdom working in you 24/7. You can imagine the type of man such a person will be. You can have it at work in you 24/7. Where you just have knowledge about everything. And those people are very dangerous. When you stand before them, before you start lying, they know already.
Why are you lying?
They know you will lie. They just know it. You will lie. Before you speak, they know whether you believe or not. They just know it. Why? There's a gift at work. They just know what to do at any point of time. They just know what to do. They never make mistakes. Because the gift of wisdom is at work. They just know where to go at the time. They never go the wrong place. Because when they are going the wrong place, even they plan going the wrong place, wisdom anyhow would bend them along the way to the right place. Wisdom is at work. You see it? And if there is anybody sitting with them and needed the voice of God, he can receive the voice and say, take prophecy at work in such a person. He can speak to you and is the very word of God to you. He can tell you the implication of your decisions. They can tell the very end of your decisions. You just told him, oh brother, I want to do this. Say, well, this is how it will end you. That is prophecy. I don't know, most of us we think until the person is jumping on one leg, like, jump, you know, the Lord is here. That is prophecy. No. You miss it. Prophecy is not that way. The gift, you can open your eyes like this and still operate in the gift. Same as the office. The same way, he doesn't need to, before he cast out a little demon, he has to fast for 2 days. No. One of the gifts is what? Gift of healing. Somebody who is operating with the gift of healing, he don't need to pray for you. You can touch him and get your healing. Just touching him. He may say, go, it is well with you. That is all you need. Because that is the gift is at work. The gift is at work. Any question concerning the gift we have discussed so far on the down ones? Oh, the gift of faith.
Hi, can you get there? Can there be a general prophecy?
A general prophecy?
Yeah, where are you going?
Yeah, for a church. And I hope most of us have received prophecy during our prayer services and you didn't see it. Most of you even heard it and you don't even know it's prophecy. It's possible, far possible. Not even possible, it happened several times and most of you didn't see it. Because you thought it's only for the first time. No. By the end of the distance, you will know as to how to deal with those things. The word of knowledge is there. You can get activated in a congregation. There is a general prophecy that is for a group of people concerning the church. If a church receives a prophecy, it's a general prophecy. It's for the whole church, not for one person. And there is a specific prophecy that is to one or a particular group of people. This is what God is telling you, saying unto you, do this. In the book of Revelation, we saw something like that, right? And he sent letters to the churches. He has sent his faithfulness. What type of prophecy is that? There was exhortation in there, there was counsel in there, there was confirmation in there, because he said he has seen their labor of love, is confirming that whatever they are doing, God was watching, but they never knew it. So So now God is confirming what they were doing. That I can see your love for each other. What is such a prophecy doing? It's confirming. When we finish all these things, we read some portions of the Bible and you identify which of the gifts is at work here. But it was never explained in the Bible that way. But when you read it, now that you know these things, you'll be able to tell this is the gift at work. This was exactly what was happening. Any other question? Any other question?
Any gifts we receive will be accounted for. What if any gift that we receive will be accounted for? But what about, like we said, like we saw from this thing, knowledge and wisdom that we're not aware of? How can we account for that?
You are not aware. You are not aware, and how do you account for it? The ones you are responsible for is the one you account for. The president of China cannot go and account for the president of that, for the nation of Ghana. The ones you are responsible, there are some that God himself forces you to do. Because should he give you a chance, you may not do it well. Like you are standing somewhere, God, you know, Spirit of God tell you, brother, move back. Or anybody come around and say, please, move back a little. You may begin to question, why? I came here before you. So why should I? And why you are talking in your head? So looking at such a thing, God does not need your consent. He does it himself. Push you back. You won't feel a push. But anyhow, you will just move back. And the car passed and you just said, how was that? Is that wisdom was at work? You see, sometimes you'll be sleeping. You just wake up from your sleep anyhow, and your door is open. You go, you lock it, you go back to bed. Wisdom will wake you up. Your eyes wouldn't be clear. You just walk by the Spirit, and your door is open. You close it, you go back to sleep. The next day, will you remember? Yes, you remember. You wake up in the night. Lock your door, and your door was open, and you lock it. That is wisdom. And wisdom is at work in you. It's time for examination. You can take this big book. You open it. Page 704. You just read some few things there, and you go, it's the same thing in there. The very page. The very page. Wisdom will cause you to open the dark place that is coming. And he will cause you to read those moments you don't even read very well. You just brush through, that is all. Wisdom will hold those things to your eyes. You go, you pour it down, you check out, that's all. That is wisdom at work. It's a force that causes you to do something without your knowledge. You don't need your knowledge here, because you will question it. But there are some of the gifts that you are responsible for. A gift like speaking in tongues, you can decide to speak or not. It's up to you. You can question it. You don't care. Like moments where the Spirit of God will wake you up in the night. Brother, wake up and pray. Wake up, and you feel like your body is paining you. Well, you wake up and you hear bad news. You say you don't understand. You see it? So, be conscious of some of these things. If you are a Christian, you are not ordinary. That is why every moment of your life, you must be conscious of what is happening. Every moment of your life. So the gifts that you have, you will praise yourself. Those are the ones you account for. You account for it. And it won't come, those things that not come in mysterious ways that you are not aware of. They are things you deliberately rejected yourself, and you are aware that you rejected it. You know it. That day of judgment, you will be like, I never knew it was the Spirit of God. You know. You knew. You wake up by yourself 12 o'clock and tell yourself you are going to pray. You do it. Is that something part of routine life? No. So if such a thing happened or occurred to you, you should know it is not ordinary. The Spirit of God is at work here. You are at a place, the Spirit of God is telling you, begin to speak in tongues. You say, but there are so many people here. So you won't speak in tongues. And you miss it. You feel like God is unfair. I saw people blew up in tongues in market places. Market. Then there was a woman, after buying everything, take taxi anyhow, she just blew up in tongues, speaking in tongues, and it was increasing. She kept shouting, kept increasing. Drunk with anointing. Others were making fun, others were making mockery, several things were going on at the market. And some two sisters decided to help her home because they are not sure as to what is happening. They helped her home, carry her, they got to her house. Armed robbers were in her house. They packed all their properties. They came in with a car. They packed everything into their car and they did not move the car. They left the car in the house and they ran away. He has got a new car. But you see, at that time, the gift to speak in tongues was activated. She can say, oh, but this is marketplace. If she were not to speak in tongues, they would take all those things away. She got home. Their two cars were stuck. They were about to move the two cars away plus their own cars. But anyhow, while she was speaking in tongues and it was increasing, they left the gift in their car. The car they brought, the car was left in the house. And they ran away, leaving the car there. He has got a new car. Just speaking in tongues, he has bought a new car. You see? So it's like that. And those moments, if you refuse to speak, I told you, God wouldn't do anything about it. And it's not a joke. He wouldn't do anything about it. You are responsible. And whatever happens, you pay for it. If you take your life, that would be the end. He will welcome you to heaven though. And you haven't completed your mission. They must say, oh, but this, I'm in heaven. No, you will enjoy heaven. You see, the price you're supposed to get, you wouldn't get it. And because you didn't complete your mission, many people might have gone to hell on account of you not completing your mission. You see,